over. Brother Raymond will now come with the intercessory and invocation.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Father. Thank you, Jesus. You're worthy. Hallelujah. Oh, we intend to give you the highest praise this morning. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Father. Thank you. Hallelujah. How excellent is your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Almighty God, we, your people, assembled this morning in this place just to say thank you. Thank you because you have been better to us than we have been to ourselves. So we come on bending knee, God, asking for you to hear our prayers this morning. So send the anointing of your Holy Spirit to fill this sanctuary, that it may move in and out and through and every pew in the pulpit and from breast to breast and heart to heart, that the Holy Spirit would have its way in this worship experience. But through it all, Father, we still want to say thank you. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for protecting us. Thank you for healing us. Thank you for providing for us. Thank you for giving us a heart, hallelujah, that is filled with love and compassion for others. Thank you, Father. Because unless we give thanks to you, God, hallelujah, what we do is null and void. So we come to worship you this morning. In spite of how we have been down through the days gone by, some of us might have forgot to pray. Some of us might have forgotten to read your word. Some of us might not have been so compassionate to someone else. But because you are a faithful and loving God, whose mercy and grace is always before us. So we say, forgive us. Help us, oh God, as we journey on this road called life, that we would do things, God, that is pleasing in your sight. Hallelujah. We want to worship you, God, in the beauty of your holiness. Because we know, God, that we can do nothing without you. So send your anointing this morning on us, Father. Hallelujah. That our minds might be changed. Our hearts would be open. Hallelujah. And we would be ever so grateful for who you are and what you're doing and what you have done, but what you are about to do, God. So stir up those gifts within us. Hallelujah. Stir it up this morning, God. For those who are listening to us by way of radio, those who are on Zoom, those who might be on Facebook or YouTube, God, you are a God who has no distance from all of that. That you can reach all of those sources and send the same power and authority that is in this house. Hallelujah. That it might reach somebody who's not got a relationship with you. But the Bible says that it is the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous that availeth much, God. And so we come this morning, oh God, believing and with our hope, hallelujah, that you will do these things for us, God. That you will, oh God, allow, hallelujah, your glory to shine around us this morning. Let us feel your presence, God. Hallelujah. Give us a sign this morning, God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We believe it, God. We believe it, God. Hallelujah. It is our belief in you, God, that will bring about hope, that will bring about prosperity, that will bring about joy. Hallelujah. So God, have your way this morning. But you have called us to be intercessors. In the name of Jesus, we lift up those, oh God, who may be mourning this morning. Those who have lost loved ones through the darkness of death. Ah, but your word says that, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, for we shall fear no evil, for thou art with us. And we like what Matthew 5 and 4 says. Hallelujah. My God, blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. So we pray, God, this morning that you will comfort the Lambert family who lay to rest, God, a sister, a daughter, and a worker for your kingdom, laid her to rest. We know, God, that she has received her crown of glory. But we pray for the family right now in Jesus' name, that you will strengthen them, that you will comfort them, and that you will allow your peace that you said transcends all understanding to be ever present. And that's with anybody who's mourning this morning, God, do it for them. Hallelujah. We call on your omnipotent power to touch all those who are infirmed in their bodies, those who are sick through cancer, those who are sick through diabetes, those who are sick through high blood pressure, those who are sick with Alzheimer's, those who are sick with mind-changing things, oh God, through drugs and alcohol, those who are, God, struggling in life because their bodies no longer work for them. We lift them up to you this morning. We lift up our brother Stephen, hallelujah, Stephen Tucker this morning, God. Thank you for the outcome of his procedure. Thank you, oh God, for changing his mind, oh God, that he should work according to your promises, God. The Bible says that if any man be in Christ, he becomes a new creature. And so we know, God, that the prayers that went out for this brother, hallelujah, they were nonstop. We bombarded heaven on his behalf, God. And we know that you answered the prayers. I like what 2 Chronicles 7 and 14 declares, that if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then you shall hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Healing is in the blood of Jesus. When they hung him on the cross and they pierced his side, his blood dropped into the ground. Hallelujah. So it's always with us. So we claim it this morning, oh God. Hallelujah. But I still like how that particular passage of scripture finishes. It says, then my eyes will be open and my ears will be attentive to the prayers offered up in this place, this house, Bethel, hallelujah. So we thank you on this morning, God. We thank you for hearing us. We thank you for answering our prayers. We thank you, hallelujah, for granting us favor because we have been obedient unto you, God. Now, Heavenly Father, for anybody else whom I might not have called by name, who needs to touch the hem of your garment this morning to be made whole, we ask, oh God, that you would do it. Hallelujah. Do it for us, God, because we're standing on your word. We're standing on your promises. We're standing and believing, oh God, hallelujah, that you are a miraculous God who's still able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask. We thank you for allowing us to come to you this morning in prayer. Hallelujah. God, have your way now in this worship experience. Bless the anointed woman of God. Hallelujah. Our pastor, whom you are going to pour out your word through her. We pray, Lord, that somebody, God, will have a life-changing experience. Somebody will raise their hand and say, hallelujah. What must I do to have a life in Jesus Christ? We thank you, oh God, not just for this anointed woman being the pastor, but we thank you for her being a mother. We thank you for her, hallelujah, being a grandmother. We thank you, oh God, hallelujah, for being a wife in Jesus' name. And so we lift up her husband, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you will cause him, oh God, to take up his bed and walk in a new way, oh God, walking with a purpose, walking with authority, but above all, God, walking in the anointing and healing power of Jesus the Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give the worship leader to you this morning, my brother in Christ, Gilbert Trott. Bless him, oh God. Bless the words that come out from his mouth this morning as he leads us into worship. Hallelujah. Bless his house, Father. Bless his wife. In the name of Jesus. Now, God, we couldn't thank you enough in Jesus' name that you would take full control of this worship experience. Send your anointing through the music, through the keyboards, Brother Sean. Hallelujah. Through the drummer, my God. Through the bass guitarist, through the soundboard, and through the video graphics, oh God, you get the glory out of all of it. No weapon formed against this worship experience shall prosper this morning, God. We claim the victory in all that we have prayed for, God, because you are our God. Hallelujah. Now let the redeemed of the Lord give you thanks, give you praise, for this is our prayer this morning, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Draw me near, blessed Lord, to the cross with Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We long for a closer walk with Jesus. Come by, Lord. Let the power of your Holy Spirit, O Heavenly Father, touch each and every one assembled, not only in this house, but over the electronic airwaves. Father, you know their needs. Some have reached out to you, crying out to you, Lord, for healing, for deliverance, crying out to you in the name of loved ones who just may be going through something that's a little bit too much for them. Kind Father, go by and touch each and every one. Give them the assurance that it is you. The deliverer of their faith. Move, Lord. Speak, Lord, as only you can. Hallelujah. Speak, Lord. Draw me to his holy name. Hallelujah to his holy name. How has he blessed you this week? How have you been blessed this week? Yeah. Have you been blessed enough to just stand and shout and declare it and say, praise be to his mighty name. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. He and he alone is worthy. The author and the finisher of our faith, he and he alone is worthy. Hallelujah. It's only by his mercy and his grace that we can get to even come here to worship this morning. Oh, hallelujah. Praise be to his holy name. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Sister Jereen will now come with
the morning scripture.
Good morning, church. We greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Sweet, sweet spirit. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning is taken from 1 Samuel 7, 7 to 12. When the Philistines heard that Israel had assembled at Mizpah, the rulers of the Philistines came up to attack them. When the Israelites heard of it, they were afraid because of the Philistines. They said to Samuel, "Do not stop crying out to the Lord our God for us, that he may rescue us from the hand of the Philistines." Then Samuel took a suckling lamb and sacrificed it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. He cried out to the Lord on Israel's behalf, and the Lord answered him. While Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to engage Israel in battle. But that day, the Lord thundered with loud thunder against the Philistines and threw them into such a panic that they were routed before the Israelites. The men of Israel rushed out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines, slaughtering them along the way to a point below Beth-kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen. He named it Ebenezer, saying, "Thus far the Lord has helped us." The word of God for the people of God.
Mine eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help coming from the Lord, the Lord which made heaven and earth. He said, "He shall not suffer thy foot, thy foot to be moved." The Lord that keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep. For the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade upon let thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve thy soul, even forevermore.
Sister Maury. Hold on, Sister Maury.
Come on, choir.
Suffer thy foot,
shout an acclamation of faith. Just to acknowledge where your help comes from. Oh my. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Sister Murray. Thank you. Thank you for making me cry. But it's a tears of joy. Tears of acknowledgement as to where my help comes from. Thank you.
Thank you, choir.
Now the pastor will come with acknowledgments and notices.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Since you know where your help comes from, give him some praise, give him some glory. Some of us had some rough week, but we made it through because our help comes from the Lord. To those listening in Radio Land this morning, we trust indeed that you are being blessed by our worship experience. To the Bermuda Industrial Union, we say thank you, we say thank you, we say thank you for providing this ministry that will go over the airways of our island home, that those who are unable to make it to the physical house, they can still be in the presence of the Lord. So may God continue to bless you and keep you is our prayer. Our birthday greetings for this week. On Monday the 17th, Brother Larry Williams will be celebrating his 68th birthday and his retirement. Amen. Congratulations, Brother Larry, and may you have a very blessed birthday. On Wednesday, July 19th, Brother Sean Tucker will be celebrating his 55th. Amen. God bless you and happy birthday to you, and may God continue to keep you. At this time, I'm going to call on Sister Leslie Robinson, our late president. She has some announcements, after which I will call on Reverend Larry Smith, who also has an announcement.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Pastor, and to our worship leader, Brother Gilbert Trott. Everybody say, cup match. Cup match. We at Bethel have a lot going on for cup match, and if Sister Gilda doesn't mind, I'm just going to remind everybody about our cup match concert. That's taking place next week, Thursday, the 27th of July, and it is at 7 p.m. The tickets are $30, and you'll see all the information on the back of your bulletin. So please come in your cup match collars and be blessed. Now I want to turn to the flyer that you all would have received today, and the flyer is about our fifth Sunday service, which is on July the 30th, Sunday, July the 30th, and this time we will be up at Flats Victoria Club Field. Amen. Isn't that beautiful? Amen. You will note that we at our lay have extended ourselves to the Flats community as our outreach for this year. And you'll recall that in April we honored some well-established businesses in the area, and so this time we are actually going to Flats and having our service. At our service on Cup Match Sunday, you know that we honor persons that have been part of Cup Match, and this year we are so happy and pleased to be honoring the most famous Cup Match player from Flats, yeah, which is Brother Dennis Wainwright. Isn't that awesome? And although, Brother Dennis, we've honored you here, this is the first time we're going to be honoring you at your home field. So I know it's going to be even more special for you. So praise God. And we will be honoring others as well. So I would like all of us to come out in our regular cup match collars. We're going to have this that's my sister over here talking about Somerset, but we're your St. George's colors, everybody. And we're going to have a wonderful day. Bring your pop-up tents, and we're asking, the lay is supplying all the food. We're having a hearty meal, but we're asking for those who will be able to give us desserts to please see myself or Sister Renee, okay? and the service starts at 11. You wanted to say something, Brother Dennis? No, okay. All right, thank you very much, everybody.
I'm afraid, I'm sorry that there are some St. George's people in the house, but nonetheless. This looks a bit like red, but that's all I can show you right now. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyway, good morning. This is from the desk of the presiding elder of our district. Health fear letter for the churches. Amen. Our health fair is coming soon. In March of this year, a health fair initiative was introduced to the conference. We, the AME Church Health Fair Committee, are now excited to share some of our plans. The fair will be held October the 28th, and we need your help to make it a reality. Amen? In the lead up to the fair, we encourage everyone, to become more physically active. You can join a walking club, you can come to the gym with me, spinning session, and even a chair yoga club, a physical challenge. Calendar will also be distributed for those who wish to participate. And if the calendar comes out, don't renege, okay? Throughout the year, similar workshops discussing topics such as heart health, asthma, mental health, and emotional wellness have been planned. Remember, our bodies are temples of God, and our health should be an important component to that. If you would like to join our planning committee, become a sponsor, or have a business you would like to be a part of the health fair, please contact healthfair@gmail.com. We'll be happy to hear from you. Be happy, be healthy, please, mind, body, and spirit. Let me be happy. Happy? Be healthy.
Healthy.
Say that louder.
Healthy.
Mind.
Body.
And spirit. Yours in Christ.
Dr. Vanita Smith.
Vanita Smith, Health Fair Committee Chairperson. Amen.
Amen.
Healthy.
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 Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Larry. Reverend Larry is on that committee, and also I understand Sister Kenneth Burgess was appointed to that committee as well. So let's mark our calendars. Those of you who are not as, who's a bit more around the middle like me, let's join in and let's get a bit healthier. Amen. Any visitors with us this morning, we ask if you would stand that we can recognize you today. Good to see Brother Dennis out this morning. God bless you, sir. God bless you, Sister Waverly, and I believe that's her sister. God bless.
Good morning, church. Good morning, church. My name is Dawn Darrell, my husband Clyde Darrell, right here, my sister Marva Bridgewater, in reference to my father passing last Sunday here at the church. We had a service for him last Saturday, I should say. Thank you, church.
Amen. Indeed, it's a pleasure to have you with us again, and know that our prayers are still with you as you go through this time of bereavement, and know that in store, earth has no sorrows that heaven cannot cure. May God continue to bless and keep you. It's offering time. As we now prepare to bring our tithes and our offering unto the Lord, there's a blessing of giving unto the Lord, not just your finances, but giving of your best. So as we come this morning, it's our prayer that you will give your best praise, you will give your best offering, and I promise you, God will restore, God will bless you abundantly. Our gracious and our eternal God, we thank you, Father, for this yet another opportunity, God, that we can come, we can worship, and God, we can present unto you our very best. So God, we're asking for your blessing on every hand and every heart that gives in accordance to your word, that indeed, Father, there may be meat in your house, there may be ministry in your house. So God, send your blessing is our prayer in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Come.
Minister it often, but it's a beautiful song because because hallelujah is the highest praise that we can give our Lord. And so we're going to minister that today, and we ask that you will join in as well.
Salvation and glory.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory. Hallelujah. He's wonderful. If you know him as wonderful this morning, say hallelujah. If God has been good to you, say hallelujah. If he's made a way out of no way, say thank you, Lord. You see, if he's down at the cricket game, whether it be county or a cup match, we'll be making all sorts of noise, but you need to stop and think about God's goodness. Think about God's grace, how he made a way for you. It's not just a song, but it's an experience what God has done for you. He's wonderful, he's wonderful, he's wonderful. Oh, praise. Hallelujah. Salvation and glory. We can forget about what he's done for this week, but just stay on salvation. We didn't deserve it, but he did it for us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Salvation and glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God, continue to rest with us. Remain with us, God. For indeed, God, we need to hear a word from you this morning, God. God, move by your anointing, move by your power, God. Not just at 60 North Shore Road, Hamilton Parish, God. But God, we know you are far greater than any location. That God, you can be in many places at one time, God. You are omnipresent. So God, go by the prison this morning. Go by the hospital, dear God. Lord, we pray you will go by the nursing homes, dear God. God, hover above Bermuda this morning, dear God. That indeed, God, we would hear your voice. That God, we would feel your presence and your anointing. God, we come today to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. But God, we've come now, God, to hear your word. So speak, Lord. There's someone that needs a word of hope this morning. They're in the pits and in the dungeons of life, God. They need to hear a word from you. God, move by your spirit. Move by your anointing, God. God, we'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Because, God, there's none like you. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Our scripture was read in our hearing this morning. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verses 7 through 12. And I will be focusing on verse 12. 1 Samuel 7 and 12. And Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen. He called it Ebenezer, saying, thus far the Lord has helped us. Thus far the Lord has helped us. I'd like to use for a title this morning, thus far. God ain't finished yet. God ain't finished yet. My apologies to all the teachers in the house and those of the radio. I know that isn't good grammar. But God ain't finished with us yet. In the second stanza of my favorite hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, we find the words, here I raise my Ebenezer. Hither by thy help I come. And I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. What
is the meaning of this term, Ebenezer? For a full understanding of this term, we need to reflect on its use, not just within a hymn, but within the Bible. The name Ebenezer occurs within the Bible on three occasions. The background of its meaning and significance begin in the first book of Samuel and the fourth chapter, where we find Israel and the Philistines at a point of conflict. Let's take a look at that first appearance. In the fourth chapter of 1 Samuel, we will find that it refers to as a place of defeat. Stay with me for a moment. Israel had set up camp near Ebenezer in preparation for battle against the Philistines. However, during this time of their history, Israel had turned its back on God. They were now worshiping false idols. They participated in all forms of rituals. They had now neglected the offerings that belonged to God. While in this sinful and rebellious state in their history, we find that there was even a greater problem. You see that even though they turned their back on God, they believed that because of the Ark of the Covenant, that God would provide protection for them in the time of battle. They failed to realize that their actions towards God determined whether or not God would be for them. They put their confidence in the ark and not in God. The Philistines came and they fought against Israel. And the battle against the Philistines, Israel would have a great defeat, and she suffered much loss. And it was in the defeat of Israel that the Ark of the Covenant was taken by the Philistines from Ebenezer and moved to another location. So it's here at the first mention of Ebenezer in the Bible, we now see it as a place of defeat and failure. But the story isn't over yet. It is there in the seventh chapter that now their place of defeat will now become a place of lament. 20 years had now passed since their defeat by the Philistines, and the Ark of the Covenant had been returned to Israel only after God inflicted on their enemies tumors and an infestation of rats. Unable to deal with the heavy hand of God, they took the ark back to its rightful owners. It is there at that time that Samuel now speaks to the people of Israel. He tells them, now if you return to the Lord with all your heart, if you turn from worshiping these strange gods, if you prepare your hearts unto the Lord and serve only him, God would deliver you from the hands of the Philistines. In short, deliverance will come only after repentance and returning to God. The people did as they were instructed and gathered at Mizpah and fasted and repented before the Lord. We need to understand that Mizpah was about some 18 miles outside of Ebenezer. And now their place of defeat will now become their place of repentance and turning to God. It was there while at Mizpah that they cried out unto the Lord. It was there that they rented their hearts and returned unto God. We find that now not only did their place of failure become their place of lament and returning to God, but as we look at verse 7 through 11,
we will find it would also become their place of victory. When the Philistines heard that the Israelites were at Mizpah, they decided it's time to go to battle against them. I find it interesting that at a time that Israel was now turning back to God, now seeking God's face, we find that the enemy was on the move. While Israel was getting itself in order, the enemy was now on the attack. Somebody needs to hear this morning, that while you're working out your soul's salvation, while you're trying to do right by God, by turning your back on the former things, that the enemy is still on the attack. The enemy was on the move. When Israel heard about the attack, they became afraid and called on Samuel to intercede on their behalf. They called on Samuel. The Philistines are coming yet again. Samuel, we need you to pray. Samuel, we need you to call on God. So Samuel heard the cry and the request of the people. And according to the text, he took a suckling lamb and offered it as a burnt offering unto the Lord. Samuel himself cried out to the Lord on behalf of the people. And here's the important part of the text. And it says, and the Lord heard Samuel. Aren't you glad that Samuel cried and Samuel called? But the real joy comes when we look at verse 10. It says, as Samuel, you understand that? As Samuel, while he was in the process of offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines grew near. So yes, he was interceding for the people, and the Philistines were drawing nearer and nearer. The more he prayed, the closer the enemy got. But I'm so glad that there's that three-letter word that I love so much in the Bible. Somebody say, but. As Samuel offered up the burnt offering, as the Philistines drew nearer, the text says, but the Lord thundered a great thunder on that day and caused the Philistines to go into a mass confusion. Somebody didn't get that. As Samuel offered up, the enemy drew near. The enemy drew near with confidence. They drew near knowing that they could defeat Israel. We did it before, and we can do it again. They were confident in their own abilities. They were confident in their history. Their confidence was in their army. But there was something different that the Philistines did not take into account. At the time that the Philistines defeated Israel 20 years before, Israel was in a different place. You see, they were not the Israel of chapter 4. You see, there's 20 years taking place between chapter 4 and chapter 7. The Philistines thought they were dealing with a chapter 4 Israel. But they failed to realize they weren't in the same place. You see, in chapter 4, they were worshiping other gods. In chapter 4, they had a form of godliness, but denied the power thereof. In chapter chapter 4, they were not walking upright with God. They were skipping and saving off on their offerings, not giving to God what was due him. They weren't living right. They weren't worshiping right. They weren't talking right. That was chapter 4, Israel. But somebody say, but. In chapter 7, 20 years later, Israel was in a different place at a different time. Yes, they messed up before. Yes, they made some mistakes. But when they got the voice of God speaking to them, calling them to repentance, Israel was a different church in chapter 7. The Philistines thought they were dealing with a chapter 4 army. Tell the devil, you're not in the same place. Tell the devil, you've heard the voice of God. Tell the devil, he defeated you once before, but he can't touch this in chapter 7. Are you a chapter 7 or are you chapter 4? Look back 20 years. Are you in the same place? Look back 20 years. Are you still suffering and moaning about the failures of the past? Or are you the Israel in chapter 7? Where you have repented, where you've now returned back to God, when your heart is now right. You no longer worship strange gods. You now serve God and only him. Israel was now in the right place for God to do a miracle. The chapter 4 shenanigans was now over. The chapter 4 waywardness is now done. The Philistines failed to realize that they were dealing with a chapter 7 believers, and they had repented and were walking right with God. So as Samuel offered the burnt offerings, and yes, the Philistines grew nearer, but God, but God, but God was working out the victory for his repentant people. If you want the victory, you need to have a repentant heart. You can't be the way you were 20 years ago and expect to get the victory in 2023. Let God give you a heart transplant. Let him wash you. Let him clean you. Let him strengthen you while we are repenting, while the sacrifice is going up. God is working out your victory.
Hallelujah.
On that day, God's supernatural power took over, showed up on the battlefield. What's your battlefield? He confused the Philistines with a loud clap of thunder. They were so afraid, they began to scatter in the front of the very people they were supposed to attack. Your enemy can be right in front of you, but keep stealing. Watch what God's gonna do. He'll fight your battles for you if you just keep still. Be still and know. Be still and know that I am God. In your face, God will confuse your enemies. The Philistine confident in their abilities, their past victories, scattered at the thunder provided by God. And only at that point did the men of Israel now go out and pursue the Philistines. I like that right there, because at the beginning, when they heard that the Philistines were coming, they were so afraid. But now they've seen the hand of God. Now they know what God can do for them. They're running to their enemies. God will turn you around. God will empower you, that you don't have to be afraid of the debt. You don't have to be afraid of the sickness. You don't have to be afraid of your tormentors. God will intervene and cause you to run towards your enemies. Their place of defeat was now turned into a place of victory. Their place of sin and lament was now turned into a place of victory. God confused the enemy and gave them the victory. Imagine the joy of seeing the Philistines on the run. Imagine the joy of seeing their enemies defeated. Just imagine how you would feel when you thought you would be destroyed, when you would be pushed aside, when you would be taken captive. But when God intervened, oh, the joy that floods my soul to see the enemy on the run, to see God turn the tables, to see God make a difference. The victory is finally theirs because God gave them the victory. We need to understand this morning that God heard their repentance. God heard their repentance. He took pity on their weeping. He answered the prayers of the crying prophet. And on that day, I like that because it says on that day. Somebody say, what day? The day of repentance, the day of weeping, the day of turning, the day of prayer. Until we get these elements right in our Christian walk, the victory will not come. We sometimes are just like Israel. We have a form of godliness, but we're denying the power of God. We want to do things our way. We want to grumble and complain. But until God hears our heart, until God hears our repentance, sees our weeping, and hears our prayers, until that day, we will remain in our state. But I want you to know God's got a victory in store for you. God has a victory in store for us. But we must get our hearts right. They finally had the victory. After all that time of living in the shadows of defeat. At the grocery store, and the lady was talking about, she was a Somerset fan. She talked about how St. George's held the cup for 20 plus years, and how they had to go through that for 20 plus years. And now it seems like the tables are being turned. We must sometimes got to go through some difficult things in waiting for a long time. And she says, until St. George's stops that in-house politics, we're going to hold the cup. And I had to let her know, sweetheart, you're right. But we need to understand, until we get it right, the victory will not come. And I'm not just talking about cricket, but I'm talking about our walk with God. Israel had to get it right. Israel had to have a repentant heart. Israel had to have a praying heart before the victory would come. So Ebenezer, here we have it as a place of defeat, a place of lamenting and a place of victory. Isn't it amazing how God can bring all that about in the same place, in the same vicinity? Some of us think we can get up and run somewhere else, but your blessing is right here in Ebenezer. Your blessing is right here. Let God do his perfect work. Stop running, stop hiding. God will change your heart where he has placed you. God placed Israel at Ebenezer. Broken, doing their own way. Then the prophet came and told them, you don't need to get right. But you know what's interesting? Nobody left and Samuel told them, you need to get right. They did what the prophet of God requested of them. The victory comes out of obedience. God gave his people the victory. My last and my final point, we find in verse 12. They now have the victory. Look at what Samuel now does. It says he sets a memorial unto the Lord. Samuel took a stone and set it between Mizpah and Sen and called it Ebenezer. But remember, the real Ebenezer was about 18 miles in the opposite direction, but it was such a significance to them, he called it Ebenezer again. You know how they have New York, New York? Now this is Ebenezer, Ebenezer. It was so good, he named it twice. And this is why he named it twice. Thus far, the Lord has helped us. Samuel erected a thankful memorial for the victory to God. It would also serve, this memorial would serve as an encouragement to the children of Israel. So this memorial, this erection that Samuel put in place would be a thankful memorial for God for the victory, and it would serve as an encouragement to Israel. I'm so glad this morning that God can change our places of defeat to places of victory. That's what God did. But when we realize that we've got the victory, it wasn't about Samuel. He gave the praise strictly to God. Samuel called it Ebenezer, which means stone of help. And it was there that they remembered what God had done for them. Ebenezer is a remembrance of divine assistance. It helps you to remember that you were with your back against the wall and God showed up. Your Ebenezer is that place when the doctor gives you some bad news, but God steps in. Your Ebenezer is that place when the bank tells you we've got to take your house, but God steps in. So when we look at the text and apply it to 2023, we can know that our Ebenezer is the remembrance that God stepped in and helped us. Ebenezer was all about the work of God. And here's the part that ties it all together. We saw what God did for Israel. But he says he named it Ebenezer because thus far, up until this point in our journey, up until this moment in time, the Lord has helped us. Thus far means that he was looking back and reflecting on what God has done, what God had brought him through. Thus far meant trusting God through the 20-year wait. Thus far means that God isn't finished with us yet. Thus far just takes it up to this point. Thus far takes it from past to present. But as we read further into the text, we learn that it just didn't stop at thus far, because God had a plan for Israel. God saw what was coming, and let's take a look at what God's plan was. When you look at chapter verses 13 through to 14, and it says that because God had intervened in the battle and gave them the victory, it says in verse 13 that the Philistines were subdued, and they came no more to the coast of Israel. The hand of the Lord was against the Philistine all the days of Samuel. So that just wasn't present, but that was future. So thus far didn't stop today, but thus far gave them a hope that the enemy that pursued you, the enemy that defeated you, the enemy that wanted to destroy you would now be subdued. Tell your enemy, you can't touch this. Thus far, the Lord has been my help. Thus far, the Lord has brought me through. Thus far, the Lord has been my keeper. Thus far, the Lord has been my sustainer. And I want you to know, thus far, God ain't finished with me yet. Thus far. It ain't over yet. We got the victory. We've repented. We've returned to God. God has heard our hearts. God has answered our prayer. And thus far, look at what God has done. Yes, we need to look back, but I want you to know, don't keep looking back, but look forward, because God ain't finished. God doesn't stop with thus far, but God's got a plan for your life. God's got some victories yet in store for you. And it goes on to the 14th verse. And the cities which the Philistines had taken from Israel were what? Restored. Thus far takes you up to now, but God's got some restoration. Those things that the enemy took from you, God will restore. We need to know and understand that God's got a greater blessing for you. There were some things that were taken from you that God wants to restore. There's some places that God wants you to go, but you've got to come with a repentant heart. You've got to seek God and call on his face.
My God. My God. My God.
Thus far. Thus far. God ain't finished with us yet. God is doing a work within us. Everything that was taken was restored. But I like in the last part of the 14th verse, and it says, and there was peace. There was peace between Israel and the Amorites. There was peace between Israel and their enemies. There will be peace between you and whatever seeks to destroy you. I'm so glad that after and from thus far, there comes peace.
Amen.
Restoration, peace, and victory. Thus far is knowing that in waiting, even if it's 20, 30, 40 years, that God is still in control. God has a plan in store for us. But we must be at the right place at the right time. I'm not talking about a physical location. Yes, they were in Ebenezer. Yes, they moved to Mizpah. But their right place was a place of repentance, of getting their heart right with God, of doing what God required of them. Repentance leads to prayer. And prayer, as we know, changes the heart of God. So I ask you this question in closing. Where are you? Are you stuck in chapter 4, living in defeat? worrying that the enemy is coming back? Are you in chapter 4 that you've forsaken the ways of God? You've got one foot in and one foot out. You see, that's what Israel was doing. They had the Ark of Covenant, and they were confident in the Ark, not in God. We do not have an Ark, but we've got a sanctuary. Our confidence is Here I raise my Ebenezer. Let me tell you the story. He was born in 1735. Robert Robinson ran the streets of London with gangs at the age of 17. He cared nothing about the church, nothing about spirituality. You see, his father died when he was a young boy. And not having a father to guide him, he fell into the wrong company. So one day, he and his gang found a drunken gypsy. And they added to her intoxication by pouring more liquor down her stomach. And then they demanded that this fortune teller give them free fortunes. She immediately looked at Roberts, pointed at him and says, "You will see your children and your grandchildren." That was a wake-up call for him. And thinking about what this drunken gypsy has said to him, it hit a spot in his heart. And he says, if he's going to live to see his children and his grandchildren, he needed to change his life. He needed to change the way he was living. So he heard that there was a revival meeting going on in the city. And he went to hear the preacher, and he tried to convince his gangs to go with him. He didn't want to go by himself. So he told the guys, "Let's go and make fun of the church folk. Let's go and heckle the preacher." But when he got to the tent meeting, that the preacher stood and took his text from Matthew 3:7, and he preached on a generation of vipers. I see. Roberts left in fear, feeling that the preacher was preaching only to him. Some years later, under conviction, at the age of 20, he now makes his life right with God and started to become a preacher himself. He wrote a letter to the preacher, who was George Bitfield, and told him that he envied the happiness that he saw on the face of the people gathered at the revival, and that he longed for that kind of happiness. And it was that decision that helped him to accept Jesus Christ and to change his life. It was 2 years later that Robert sat and penned the words to "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, calls of songs of loudest praise. Then the next part, here I raise my Ebenezer. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Oh, let that grace like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. And here he wrote the words, prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord. Take and seal it. Seal it for thy cords above. But here's the tragedy in his story. Some years later, Robert did stray away from God in a backslidden condition. One day while he was traveling along on a stagecoach, the only two people in the stagecoach was himself and an unknown young lady under God's operation. You know how God works. This young lady was humming the very song that he wrote. Come thou fount of every blessing. He tried as much as possible to get her to change the subject. It was getting to his soul. The more he tried, the more she began pressing him on this great hymn of the church. She wanted to know, what do you think about the words to this hymn? He responded, ma'am, I am that poor, unhappy soul that wrote that hymn years ago. He would do anything to find that place again. And she simply said, sir, streams of mercy, no matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, streams of mercy are still flowing. You see how God worked in his life? Thus far, but God wasn't finished with him yet. By the time he and the young lady parted ways, he made his commitment back to God, and he was in good fellowship with God. His Ebenezer was a place of remembrance that God was helping him in his journey. Here I raise my Ebenezer. Pause and think for a moment. Those places in your life when you know beyond a shadow of a doubt, you didn't need the pastor to tell you. You didn't need the steward board to tell you. You didn't need the intercessory prayer team to tell you. You know for yourself that you had an encounter with God. That he came to your help and your assistance. That is your Ebenezer. Hear God. I raise my Ebenezer. And remembers God of where you brought me from. Remembers God of what you've done for me. Stop and think of God's goodness. Reflect on where God has brought you from. And just remember, God ain't finished with you yet. Our gracious and our eternal God, we thank you this morning, God, that God, even in the midst of our struggles, God, you're working on our behalf. That God, in the midst of our failures and our defeats, God, you're setting up a comeback story that's second to none. God, in the meantime, while you are waiting for us to get in the right spiritual place, God, continue to speak to our hearts and our minds. God, calls us to humble ourselves before you, to repent before you, God, to turn back to you, God. God, you've been faithful. God, you've been good. God, forgive us. Forgive us, God, for our waywardness. Forgive us, God, for our backsliding. Forgive us, God, for our arrogance. Forgive us, God, for trusting in things rather than in you. Forgive us, God. We come today, God, seeking your face. We come today, God, to repent of our sins. We come today, God, to ask for your forgiveness, that God, from this day, from this moment, God, we will turn and worship you, the one and the only true and living God. God, move by your spirit. Over the airways, over Zoom, over Facebook, over YouTube, God, over the radio, God, speak to some heart, God. They're still comfortable in doing it their way. Some heart, God, that is trusting in the things made with human hands. Touch hearts, God, touch minds, God, until we get to that place of repentance. So God, we give you the praise. God, we give you the honor. God, we give you the glory. Thank you for your patience, God. Thank you, God. We come, Father, unto you. So God, have your way. In the name of Jesus the Christ, let every believing heart say, amen. Amen. If there's one today, whether on Zoom or any of the social medias, maybe you're in the house and you've just gotten caught up in all of this. God, now once you get caught up in this, him and you, it doesn't matter how long you've been a member at Bethel. It doesn't matter how long you've worked in the church. God is waiting for you to repent. God is still waiting on you. And they were still his children. God delivered them out of Egypt. They went up, they went down, they denied. They did all sorts of mess, but it never changed who they were to God. You can run as much as you want. You can't run from God. Once God gets a hold of you, there is nothing that can take you out of his hand. We need to surrender, not to Bethel, not to African Methodism, not to any church made with human hands or any denomination. God wants you to surrender to him. Church membership has its place, but church membership without a relationship with God still puts you on the path to hell. Will you today realize that God wants you? God loves you. God is calling you. He knows your mess that you're doing, so don't say, let me clean it all up first. Come just as you are. Bring all your mess. Then you will know God did it, that he will save you. The doors of the church are open to you today. Don't let the person next to you deter you from coming. They do not have a heaven or a hell to put you in. It's about you getting your soul right with God. Is there one today? If you're in Zoom, put something in the chat. Carmen will let me know, and we'll connect you and help you connect with God. Is there one? Speak, Lord. Move by your spirit, God. Convict, God. Give them no rest, God, until they repent unto you. It may take a day. It may take 2 days, a week, a year. It took Israel multiple times, but in this instance, it took them over 20 years. Don't wait that long. Now is the time of salvation. If there's one. Here's my heart. Take. Secure it, God. Let every heart say, amen.
strength to be. Let that grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering hearts to thee. Grown to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Grown to live the God I love. Is my heart, Lord, take and clean it. Liquid for the Hallelujah.
Thank you for the word, Pastor. Oh, praise his name. Praise his name. Praise his name. Let's just take a moment and meditate on that message. The Spirit of the Living God is here, church. Ooh. Yes, you are my desire. You are my desire. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again. To hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else could take your place.
Nothing else can take your place.
to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you. Hallelujah. 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 You know, this is the kind of atmosphere you can just stay in all day. What a sweet, sweet spirit. What a sweet spirit. What a sweet spirit. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Sean, Spirit. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God. Praise his name. Praise his name. We'll now have the benediction.
That was it. There's no better prayer to leave on. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh. Yes, worship has ended, but your anointing still lingers. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. As we leave this place, God, we will meet someone who will need your anointing. So, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh. Melt us, mold us, God. Use us, God, for your glory. May the Spirit of God rest on you and you and you and you, and especially you. To him be all power and dominion. Linger if you want, go when you want. Let God speak. Move by his Spirit. This is sweet. I won't put an end to this. That's the perfect benediction. And as those hymns and the worship this morning was hymns of prayer that you sang to God, that you connected with God, that's the difference in today. We didn't have to tell you worship, shout, and do. It's your connection with God. No better way to end the service than Spirit of the Living God. Fall afresh on this place, on the drummer, on the choir, on the organist, on the ushers, on the multimedia, on your congregation, on those on Zoom, on those on the airways, Spirit. Yeah.